Good morning. This is Richfield Lutheran Church's video worship service for Sunday, January 23rd. I'm Pastor Brian. With me today are MB as assisting minister, Paul on the organ, and Mary as our vocalist. Our gospel is Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. God's glory is revealed in the reading of Scripture. Gather round, listen up, and glimpse the glory of God. Our prelude is Adagio by Mendelssohn. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our gathering hymn is, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord God, you have caused the Holy Scriptures to be written for the nourishment of your people. Grant that we may hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that comforted by your promises, we may embrace and forever hold fast to the hope of eternal life, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Near the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, he visits his hometown of Nazareth. In the words of Isaiah, he states and claims his identity, purpose, and mission. This is the Holy Gospel according to Luke, the fourth chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus, filled by the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The time was 500 some years before Jesus would be born. The prophet Isaiah looked out over Jerusalem, the holy city of the promised land of the chosen people of God. And the prophet Isaiah wept. The people of God had been through a lot. Under Kings David and Solomon, the kingdom of Israel attained wealth, power, and influence. They had it all. They went from down in the dumps nothing to being fat cats in just two generations. But then things went downhill quick. The kingdom turned in upon itself and erupted in civil war. A nation divided against itself cannot stand. The people and their riches were soon picked off by foreign powers. By the time of the prophet Isaiah, things were starting to look up. God had once again freed his people and led them back to Jerusalem. Now the people got religion, and they were rebuilding Jerusalem in hopes of making Israel great again. But oh, the corruption, the injustice, and much of it done in the name of religion. All the prophet Isaiah sees is that the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. And you know what? This doesn't bother the rich one bit. God's covenant that the people of God are blessed to be a blessing is given lip service by the powers that be. And that's about it. They talk a good talk, but it's all for show and really just meaningless noise. They might as well talk like the grown-ups do in a Charlie Brown cartoon. Wah, 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 wah. The prophet Isaiah looks out at this scene and he hears the word of the Lord. Despite what the powers that be say, God favors the underdog, the powerless. Just because they are down on their luck does not mean God has abandoned them. It does not mean that they somehow deserve what they get, which is what the powers that be keep telling them. Who are these people whom the prophet Isaiah says God favors? Now, today we would call them the disadvantaged, those who are excluded because of some factor or another, such as education, not enough or the wrong kind, gender, women especially, which are half the people, family heritage, grandparents who came from one country versus another, religion, whether they've got enough, as authorities define righteousness, their line of work, economics, race, sexual orientation, and so on. This is about more than being financially poor, as we usually think of the poor. This is more about than what we call the poor in spirit. These are those people about whom we say they're down on their luck, those less blessed, those for whatever reason just don't deserve to be heard. These so-called people are those people who, well, if they came to the annual meeting of a congregation, we would hope that they would sit in the back. And if they did stand up to say something at the annual meeting of the congregation, we would sit patiently and then would quickly say, thank you, and move on as if they had never spoken. These poor are those without a voice. We don't take them seriously. Well, because we who aren't so disadvantaged know better. We've drawn lines that separate them from us, lines that separate the insider from the outsider, and they are standing on the other side of our line. And Isaiah says, whenever we draw lines that separate them from us, well, God has this annoying habit of standing on the other side of our line. This is the prophecy Jesus stands up and reads before his home congregation in Nazareth. He reads, God's Spirit is upon me. He's chosen me to preach the message of good news to the poor, sent me to announce pardon to prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the burdened and battered free, to announce this is God's year to act. Now, this was Isaiah's prophecy from 500 some years earlier. The day is truly coming when there would be one, the anointed one, the Messiah, the Christ, who will usher in the kingdom of God. And then everything will be reset back to the way it's supposed to be, back, way back, as in the Garden of Eden. That is what the year of Jubilee is like. That's what the prophet Isaiah was referring to when he said the year of the Lord's favor. Every 50 years, the farmland is to lie fallow for 2 years. All leases expire. All debts would be forgiven. All slaves would be released. And everyone would return to the original land of their family's tribe. So everything is reset back. Everyone gets a fresh start. Everyone would be on a level playing field. It's like a reboot for a computer. But this was one law that the Israelites forgot to observe. The poor remembered that it's in their Bible, but the powers that be kept forgetting that it was in there. Is this good news? If you're poor, marginalized, or disadvantaged, you're darn right it is. But if you're doing okay, it's really not good news, is it? And this is why Jesus' message was not well received, as we will hear in next week's gospel. Now, where we pick up the story, Jesus has just been baptized and has spent the last 40 days in the wilderness being tempted by Satan. And now he returns home. And as he always did, he went to worship on the Sabbath. He's asked to read the scripture text and to share a few comments, as was their order of worship. He reads this prophecy from Isaiah, a prophecy of the time when God's anointed one will usher in the kingdom of God. The time is coming when God's anointed one will reset the world back to a level playing field, despite how comfortable we have grown to the status quo. Jesus reads this prophecy, rolls up the scroll, hands it back to the attendant, and sits down to share a few comments or observations. Then he says, I'm all that. Think of the run-up to the midterm elections next year. And we're going to hear platforms, those things the various candidates promise they will do if we elect them. Well, this is Jesus' platform. If you elect Jesus to be King of Kings, this is what his kingdom will be like. Well, that's not really quite it, is it? I mean, this is more like Jesus' inaugural address. I mean, he has already been elected King of Kings, elected by God himself. This is Jesus taking office. This is his inaugural address. This is Jesus clearly stating what he is all about. Jesus says this is his mission statement, the business he is in. This is the kingdom of God that Jesus is ushering in. Now, isn't this great news? A second chance on life. But hold on here. I mean, have you noticed something odd here, something askew? I mean, this was 2,000 years ago that Jesus gave his inaugural address in his hometown of Nazareth. 2,000 years ago. And you know, I don't think things have really improved that much. There's just as much corruption and injustice as 2,000 years ago at Jesus' inaugural address. Just as much corruption and injustice as the prophet Isaiah complained about 2,500 years ago. The rich are still getting richer. The poor are still getting poorer. They're still captives. They're still blind. They're still oppressed. The disadvantaged, the marginalized are still excluded and ignored. So what do we say about that? I mean, is all this just some pipe dream, a pie in the sky by and by? So just some a really nice idea to think about? Think about it this way. When the Emancipation Proclamation was issued in the middle of the American Civil War, the slaves who lived within the realm of the Confederacy remained in bondage. Many did not know about the proclamation when it went into effect. Its authority was denied and nullified by local and regional powers. And yet, President Lincoln, in both his words and his claim to authority over the whole of the split and rebellious Union, contended that the proclamation was nonetheless true and real. And so this proclamation became the herald of a fuller freedom, a fulfillment yet unreached. Even though the Confederate powers that be defied President Lincoln's authority and said he's not the boss of them, the Emancipation Proclamation was still true. Even though many slaves lived in ignorance of their freedom, the Emancipation Proclamation was still true. Even though the powers of this world prefer things the way they are and try to tell us that this kingdom of God stuff is, well, something for when we die, not here and now, Jesus' proclamation is still true. Even though there are many who have yet to hear of this freedom and true life, Jesus' proclamation is still true. So what do we say about all this then? I mean, if this was Jesus' mission statement, the business he was in, wouldn't it make sense that this is the business the church is in too? Extending the kingdom of God to all. Being a community where there are no lines, no outsiders. A community where everyone is welcomed and embraced and heard and valued. After all, as the Apostle Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians, we are the body of Christ. All of us, you and me. Individually, each one of us is a member, a body part of the body of Christ, each with our different and diverse functions is needed. We're not all the same, and that's a good thing, because the body needs all its different parts, all working together to live and thrive. So if we exclude someone from the body, what body part are we missing? So when we so hobble the body, well, this then is our mission. It's Jesus' mission to get all the body parts back together. Apparently, a big part of our problem is some of the body parts think they can do without the others. As the Apostle Paul put it, can you imagine the eye telling the hand, hey, get lost, I don't need you? Or the head telling the foot, you're fired, your job's been phased out. Well, as a matter of fact, in practice, it works the other way, that the lower the part, the more basic and more, therefore more necessary, it's indispensable. cleansed. Do you hear that? Necessary, indispensable. And so, the way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on every other part. The parts we mention, the parts we don't. The parts we see, the parts we don't. And if one part hurts, well, every other part is involved in the hurt and in the healing. Not only are we all in this together, not only do we need each other, but this is God's plan, God's design. In this surprising combination of diverse and different body parts, here true life is found. This is the kingdom of God Jesus ushers in. This gospel is Jesus' inaugural address. This is the business Jesus is in. And because we, well, you and me, are the body of Christ, this is our business too. What a fun, curious business it is, building up the body of Christ by opening the body to new and diverse body parts, the very people whom God favors. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Our hymn of the day is Let Streams of Living Justice.
Upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all God has made. You reveal yourself to us in the reading of Scripture. Fulfill your word through the faithful witness of your church. Send us out to bring your liberating good news to all people. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
All creation proclaims your handiwork. Teach us to love the intricate and beautiful bodies that you have created. Bless tiny insects, enormous whales, and every creature in between. Sustain species at risk of extinction. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You desire that there be no dissension among us. Where we are divided in our society, nation, or world, come quickly to reunite us into one body. Ease conflict, dispel violence, and bring an end to war. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Anoint with your spirit all who seek your favor. Grant provision and justice for people living in poverty, people living with disability, those living in pain, or those living under oppression. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Build up the body of Christ in this place. Bless the variety of ministries in this congregation, especially those we name in our hearts. Empower us to freely welcome and deeply value each person who enters into worship and ministry among us. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving, we lift before you the saints of whom the promise of salvation has been fulfilled. Tend to those who mourn. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
You can support this and other of God's ministries through Richfield Lutheran Church today through our website, richfield-lutheran.org. Thank you for your faithful generosity. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
This Sunday, January 23rd, in addition to this video recording and its phone-in option, we have in-person worship at 9:15. There'll be an informational meeting for discussion and conversation afterwards as we prepare for vote on the 2022 annual budget and design dreams for our future. Next Sunday, January 30th, our gospel reading is Luke chapter 4, verses 21 through 30. People in Jesus' hometown are initially pleased when he hears that God will free the oppressed. Their pleasure turns to rage when he reminds them that God's prophetic mission typically pushes beyond human boundaries, so that mercy and healing are extended to those regarded as outsiders. Until then, go forth with God's blessing. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in, today and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn is, "The Spirit Sends Us Forth to Serve."
Christ into a weary world, share the good news.
Thanks be to God.
Our postlude today is Fantasy in A minor by Bach.